the Gospel of Luke. What I have done in the first section is to emphasize a few things. Number one, we have talked about understanding that inspiration does not mean dictation. That's the Islamic view. We do not believe in that. God used human processes. They wrote letters or they wrote books that later on were put together. Okay. The first five books, I believe, were written by many people, including Moses. And the reason we call it the Book of Moses is not because Moses wrote everything. Please understand. Name of Moses is given because he's the main authority, not the main author. For example, 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel. You know, there are these two books. Why were they called 1 Samuel? Not because Samuel wrote it. Because in 1 Samuel chapter 25, Samuel is dead. Still some more part of 1 Samuel is to be written, and 2 Samuel also will be written. So Samuel is not writing it. Who is writing it? God's people are writing it. But to honor Samuel, the name of Samuel is given there. In fact, we do not know the authors of most of the books of the Old Testament. Many of the Psalms, we don't know who the authors are, or Proverbs, we don't know. Though traditionally we'll say Ecclesiastes written by Solomon, maybe, maybe not. Doesn't matter. Because the authorship is not so important. God's people saw that these books were life-giving. That's why they kept it. And so, that's the key understanding. Secondly, I emphasized that the four Gospels were written to different audiences. None of the writers knew one day a New Testament is coming and their Gospel will be put alongside other Gospels. None of them knew it. Neither did Paul when he wrote some of those letters. Right? So the New Testament came later in God's plan. So all these writings are there so that our faith can be based on solid evidence and firm foundations. By the way, we have two big Gospels, Matthew and Luke. Which is longer? Matthew. That's a good answer, and not the right answer. The reason we say Matthew is longer is because it has 28 chapters and Luke has 24. The only problem is the chapters of Matthew are longer. So lengthwise, Luke is longer than Matthew. Remember, these chapters, divisions were given later on. So the longest gospel is Luke. Longest of the four gospels is the biggest gospel. And as I mentioned already, Luke and Acts together, along with Paul, are the two main writers. You know, 20% of our New Testament is Luke and Acts. So there's a close connection with the book of Acts. They both have the same addressee. Luke is writing to a man called Theophilus. Looks like he's a very important person. So he calls him like, Your Honor, you know, most excellent. So I have a feeling he is probably a very wealthy man or a very honorable man, important position. And there is a guess that he may be the sponsor for these two books. You know, anybody who sits down to write, you find writing is very difficult. First, there are a few of my friends who are very good at writing. And they can write 3,000 words in a day. Phew. Nice, good writing. I struggle to write. I didn't write much. I contributed to a major commentary, just 100,000 words, a few little bit here and there. But writing is not easy. And to write something like Luke and Acts, it did not happen in a few weeks even. It would have taken a long time. Now to sit down and just have the luxury of writing, you have to push aside so many of your other things. How do you do that? The only way I could finish some of my studies was because I had scholarships so that I could focus. I was married, I had two children, and yet I could finish my studies because I got scholarships to study. You can't do that without somebody sponsoring you. So my guess is that Theophilus sponsored Luke. You know, he would tell Luke, hey, Luke, you need to sit down and write down some of these things. You're so good at writing. Sir, very difficult, sir. Six kids, sir, and my private practice is also there, and very difficult. I'm just my guess, okay? Maybe when you find he had five, not six, you know. But the point is, maybe he said, hey, what are you saying? I will take care of all that. Why don't you just take a break and I will take care of all your needs. Write this down. And that's what he does. And he says that he has carefully done research to put these words down. Now, the next question. Why then, if Luke and Acts were written together, part one, part two, in your New Testament, how are they? Matthew, Mark, Luke, then comes Acts, and then comes the letters of Paul. Why were they separated? Two quick reasons. You are welcome to write it down. Number one, Luke fits with the Gospels, of course. So Matthew, Mark, Luke, he fits with the Gospels. And they did not want to put John, Matthew, Mark, John, Luke, Acts. Why? Look at that diagram. Because John is very different. Very different. You'll not find a single parable in John. Interesting. Jesus used parables, right? We're going to enjoy the parables of Luke. So this had to be put together. These three had to be put together. And then John. The second thing, reason probably they were separated in the canon, New Testament, was Acts serves as an introduction to the letters of Paul. Acts serves as an introduction to the letters of Paul. So that, otherwise imagine you turn to Romans and you start reading somebody called Paul, Apostle Paul. Who is this man? From where did he come? We didn't read about him. Who is he? But thankfully, just before that, you have the book of Acts, where he's introduced. And you know good amount, number of things about him. Okay, so now his letter. That's why probably the books in the New Testament are arranged like that. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, which will now help us to understand the letters of Paul. Next question. Where is Luke mentioned by name in these two books? In Luke and Acts, where is he mentioned by name? The answer is nowhere. He's not mentioned anywhere. You will not find the name of Luke mentioned in Gospel of Luke or in the book of Acts. He's not mentioned anywhere. Then, where in the New Testament can we find some mention of Luke? Is he mentioned at all? Yes. Write down these references. Colossians 4:14. Philemon verse 24. And 2 Timothy 4:11. 2 Timothy 4:11. These are the only three places he's mentioned by name. As a travel companion of friend of Paul. Very interesting. By the way, there are two other places in the New Testament that some unnamed brother is mentioned. And some of us think it could be Luke. One place is 2 Corinthians 8:18. And another one is Philippians 4:3. Philippians 4:3 is a very interesting passage where Paul is talking about two wonderful women leaders. And unfortunately, they have little ego clashes. That happens for men also. Okay, so it's not that only women have ego clashes. And so in verse 3, he says, I ask you, my dear friend, if you can please help to bring some kind of understanding between these two wonderful women, because they have worked with me. They are wonderful co-workers. Okay? And so that one brother, who is the? I'm guessing it could be Luke, but we don't know. All right. How can we know that Luke is the author of the gospel named after him? Now, this is a little technical. It's not so important, but quickly we would like to finish this. When you read the book of Acts, there are some what we call V passages in Acts. V passages. What do you mean? Suddenly the narrative suddenly becomes, and we went. Look at Acts 16, for example. Acts 16. Till now, it is in third person, the narrative. But in Acts 16, verse 10, after Paul had seen the vision, we got ready. Very interesting. So it looks like the writer has entered the story here. You get it? Became first person plural. So there are these we passages here and there in the book of Acts. That is one. The next strand is, we know that he was an occasional companion of Paul. That we know. He was an occasional companion of Paul. And then thirdly, and maybe that's a clincher, that was a unanimous tradition in the early church. In the early church, there were no other traditions about who could have written these two books. It was a unanimous tradition that Luke, who's mentioned in the New Testament three places, was the author of this gospel and the book. So that is how we have, by tradition, ascribed that title, the gospel according to Luke. Please understand, he was not one who saw Jesus. He never saw Jesus. He came later on into the faith, but God uses him to give us this gospel. Now, Luke may have been a Gentile, probably. Some think he may have been a convert to Judaism, and then he became a Christian. By the way, the word Luke is not a Christian name. Now, for many of us, certain names, when we hear them, we think they are Christian, like Paul, right? Is Paul a Christian name? Yes. Probably a person from another faith in India will not name their son John, Paul, Joseph. They will not. That is traditionally used by Christians. So Paul is considered a... Yeah. Paul is different, you know. Swarup Paul, that is different, but not Paul. So we think Paul is a Christian name. It's not. It's a well-known Greek-Roman name. That's why if you read in the book of Acts, there'll be a man called Sergius Paulus. He's not a Christian. It's a common name. So we think certain names have become Christian for us. Luke is again Christian. You know, several names we find in the New Testament, we think they are Christian. There is not a single Christian name in your Bible. What do you mean by that, Pastor? I still remember when my daughter was born and we named her Priyanka. And of course, she has a middle name, Anne. So some people ask, Pastor, you don't have any Christian name for her? I said, her Christian name is Priyanka. There is no Christian name in the Bible. The names in the Old Testament are Hebrew names, but some of them are not even Hebrew. What is Abednego? You know the meaning of Abednego? We say the God of Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego is with you. You know what does Abednego mean? It's like saying Ram Charan. Abednego means the servant of the God Nego. So is that a Christian name? No. Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. These are all Babylonian names. So in our mind, because of association, we think they are Christian names. Luke was a general Gentile name, a Greek name, and he may have been a Gentile who became a Christian, or he may have gone through becoming a Jew once and then coming to follow Christ. Finally, where does Luke get his material for his gospel? Let's read Luke 1, 1 to 14. This is very helpful as we begin to understand how the gospels were written. You see, interestingly, the other three gospel writers never tell us how they wrote it. No preface, nothing, not even a few words to say what they are doing. Hardly anything, you know. So you have to kind of guess what they're doing. But Luke takes this time to give a little introduction. And that's helpful for us to read. Luke 1. Many have undertaken to draw up an account of the things that have been fulfilled among us. So there are other writers too in his time. Just as they were handed down to us. That means that's a language of tradition. Luke is not an eyewitness. If you remember that previous thing I said, the Gospels are based upon eyewitness accounts. Luke is not an eyewitness. But he says we have received it. From whom? From those who from the first were eyewitnesses and servants of the word. In other words, we have received it from eyewitnesses and servants of the word. That's how we got it. We got it from them. So Luke is not claiming to be an eyewitness, but he got it from He is going around getting it from reliable sources. With this in mind, since I myself, this is the only place where he speaks in first person, I myself, I have carefully investigated everything from the beginning. I have carefully gone around, done research, in other words. This is like a PhD, double PhD thesis. Okay? I too decided to write an orderly account so that you may know the certainty of the things you have been taught. So I'm writing this so that you will know the things you have been taught. So it looks like Theophilus is a believer, and I want you to know the certainty of the things taught. I have done careful investigation, he says. Now, what I find very interesting is what he did not say. He did not sound very spiritual in this, did he? Some of us may have said, the Lord put on my heart to write this gospel. So I fasted and prayed for 40 days. And then when I sat down to write, the Spirit of God came upon me and my hand just moved like this. What I find something beautiful about is he does not sound spiritual. He is. He says, I have carefully done it. And this gospel will mention the Holy Spirit more than the other gospels. And he's going to go into the book of Acts, which is the book of the Holy Spirit. He's a deeply spiritual man. He's a deeply prayerful man, but he doesn't talk about it. Interesting. I thought I'd tell you that. All right, so where did he get his material? First thing to remember, Luke is not an eyewitness. He's not an eyewitness. Okay? But he had eyewitnesses as sources. So where is he getting his stuff from? For example, I'm going to read the story about angel coming to Mary. How do you think that story comes to Luke's hand? And how does he write that story? Sorry? Mary would have told him. We don't know how old would Mary have been when Luke wrote it. We have no idea. Now, it's possible. Or Mary's closest friend, maybe a young girl who was always with Mary, and she goes around and she hears Mary tell the stories and she can tell Luke everything. I have heard her tell this 100 times. Let me tell you what she said. So wherever it is, this is the way Luke puts the stories together. He is not watching it on a video and putting it down. You get it? So realize how the humanity of the writing of Scripture. And by the way, that's a wonderful encouragement because God uses ordinary people like you and me. We don't have to be some kind of angelic being to be used by God. With all our limitations, God will use us to do His work. That's the way God works. That's the big difference between the Christian faith and other faiths where sometimes you have to have this magical, supernatural thing. The supernatural is the natural in a super way. Super, man, super. That doesn't mean it's some other planet. How was the meal? Oh, super. You know, it's supernatural. God uses like that. God uses ordinary people like us who have many hiccups. You know, we struggle, we make blunders, we make mistakes, and still God uses us. That's good news. Isn't that wonderful? So, this is how Luke puts the gospel together. There are those couple of images. Can you recognize those images? Elizabeth and Mary, all right. Simeon, all those are two images, beautiful stories. You know, these are all unique stories in the Gospel of Luke. You will not find it anywhere else. It's beautiful. So, by the way, one more thing, what were his sources? One more thing to mention, he had eyewitnesses sources, but remember in that diagram, he also used Mark and what we call Q. He also used that. So Mark was available to him. This is the majority view, that Mark's gospel was written earlier, so he had access to Mark, and also access to some sources which we call Q. So through these ways, he puts it together, he does research, and he goes around. My guess is somebody tells him, do you know, there is this guy who knew Peter very, very well. You always traveled with him. Where is he? He is far away. So he travels all the way, goes and spends a few days, starts taking down notes, and then he puts this gospel together in his own beautiful way. Very different from Matthew, very different from Mark, very different from John, others.